I think now our panel discussants can come up. We're going to have Dr. Chaudhary be our moderator, and we have Laurie English from Excela Healthcare coming up. Christopher Bellicini, is he here? Oh, there you are. Good to have you. He's an osteopathic doctor. Laurie Sendro from Faith in Action, which is a United Way program that the Sisters of Charity are very involved with. And we have Jessica Sanzotti. Was she able to make it? There was sort of a, we're sort of pinch hitting here a little bit today, so you have to bear with us. The topic today that Dr. Chaudhary is going to discuss is the impact of integrative medicine and shifting paradigm of the delivery of healthcare. And I want you to know before we begin that the Sisters of Charity have been extraordinarily active of Seton Hill, let alone the entire Federation of Sisters in Healthcare, for quite a few years. Not just education, although that's been the primary focus of the ministry. The Sisters are apostolic in nature. They derive, their roots are from, of course, Elizabeth Seton, but it's a French. It came out of St. Vincent de Paul, St. Louis, Marillac. They believe in reaching out, not staying in the convent. They reach out to people where they are. That's something that Dr. Chaudhary was saying about poverty. You could have been at the Monroeville Mall. You could have just walked in to go shopping, and something could have happened to you. You had nothing to do with it. What is your level of responsibility? Do you move to a nicer suburb, or do you stay and do you try to figure out how to create resolution rather than be part of the problem? So I think that that was a wonderful comment, and I think if you want to know more about that, some of the people you need to learn to speak with and develop their friendship are the Sisters of Charity. They have a lot to say about that. So Dr. Chaudhary, you can begin your panel discussion.
All right, so psychiatrists never get much time to talk, so when they are given that opportunity, they don't shut up. We always are listening. Oh, tell me more about it. Isn't that cute? You know, we always are listening. But I promise my staff, that's why I have two staff members here who tell me very bluntly it's time for me to shut up. Right, Kim and Crystal, you know, they have known me for the longest. They said, I ask them sometimes during our meeting, so what do you have to say? They said, well, we only can say if you shut up. Isn't that more or less what you tell me? So that's why I go on these long trips. All right, so here's where we are at. I kind of looked at, I just began to consult as Sister of Charity, I would say a year or 2 years ago, something like that. And we actually sat down in this room, you know, Sister Judy, myself, Sister Catherine, and we were saying, well, let's do something. And I was stunned by a couple of things. One, right on this hill sat some very beautiful educational settings. You know, there's a Seton Hills University, you know, there's a medical school, in the close proximity, you know, there is, you know, Excela Health System, and there are many more, you know. And I said, oh, it would be so really nice for all of us to come together and have a conversation and begin to connect the dots of various strengths, because each system provides different strengths. So the idea was to have the conversation going and even get to know what each institution is doing. And so that was our intention for the panel, so that we can learn. Sometimes we can be living together, but we are not knowing each other as well. And we thought that only good things will come out of conversations about healthcare dialogue and wellness. And so with that note, I will just invite our first speaker to speak. It's mine.
Yes. My name is Chris Bellicini. I'd like to thank everybody for the invite to be part of this panel. I've had the honor of meeting Sister Judy, who extended the invitation to me. I arrived here approximately 8 years ago. I work as an orthopedic surgeon for Excela Health System. In that time, I've taken care of quite a few of the sisters locally and had the honor to meet Sister Judy, and the patients have always been wonderful. the easiest to care for, and I believe that it has enabled me to practice medicine the way I would prefer to practice, because it takes away all the frustration, because they truly listen, they're compliant, and they understand. They understand what needs to be done. Many of us already know that an educated patient leads to the best outcome, and there's no better patient than one who trusts their doctor. It takes away all the difficulty to provide quality care.
Hi, good morning. Thank you for inviting Excela Health here this morning. I'm Laurie English, and I'm the Chief Human Resource Officer for a population of 4,600 employees at Excela Health. So we've got quite a challenge, even within our own population. Our mission is to improve the health and well-being of every life we touch. That is our mission at Excela Health. And when we stood back and looked at our own population, we need to take care of our employees first, so that as you come into our system as a patient, our employees are well, and they can take the best care of themselves, their families, as well as you. So we started a wellness journey. Healthcare, as Dr. Chaudhary showed you, is extremely expensive, and it's not going backwards, it's going forwards. So when we looked at our health insurance, and it was about $30 million a year for 6,900 lives on our health insurance. And Highmark, our carrier, came to us and said, you know, you're not going to be able to sustain this benefit level for your employees if you do not put in a wellness program. So, of course, you know, we were starting to look in and starting to put that together. And true to their word, they came back the following year and said, you have a 27.5% increase. You can do the math on $30 million and figure out what that cost is to an organization of our size. And you know, that impacts our bottom line. We're a not-for-profit, so you know, break even is what not-for-profits are to do, but you need to make money to be able to invest in capital and equipment and technology. So we realized we could not sustain this for our, very long. So we put in a wellness program with Highmark and their platform, and we gave our employees $150 incentive to participate in the program. It was taking a wellness profile and answering some questions and making some lifestyle changes. This could be a guessing game, but how many people out of 4,600 employees do you think $150 took advantage of that? Any guesses?
4,000.
4,000? This is like Jeopardy. Anyone else? Want a guess?
300.
300? Okay. We had 98 employees. So, you know, we took a step back. First of all, we thought we must pay them too much because the $150 wasn't really intriguing. But we realized we had to take away the incentive or change the incentive to get them motivated. And I may not know this, but healthcare workers really are not that healthy. And the reason being is that they're busy taking care of everyone else, and they put themselves last. And they really just don't have much left in order to take care of themselves. So we really had to change our culture. So we had to take out a carrot and or a stick and paint it orange and make them understand and think that it was good for them. So we started saying, well, if you don't participate, we'll charge you $15 more per pay for your health insurance. Anyone want to guess how that worked? You know, when we started biometric screenings and getting our population to come in and learn what their numbers were, and I can tell you, Ron Ott is sitting back there and his team, our well-being center, and it's the staff who are dietitians and clinicians, and they started the biometric screenings for our staff. And I would like to say we were very popular because people realized we were trying to look out for them, but we were not the most popular people. I parked my car in several different locations. We were called communists, actually. Employees, you know, when you're starting to change a culture, change is very difficult. And so the employees were not real receptive when this change came, but they didn't want to pay $15 per pay either. So they came unwillingly to our screenings, but for the first time we learned that our employees really had not been to a physician in 5 to 10 years. and because we required them to give their physician's name so that we could send the results to their physician. And we had over 500 people that had not built a relationship with their physician in some way, shape, or form. So we actually, over time, have been able to change that. And in our last screening, which is required, we only had about 10 people, and they're about 20 years old, that didn't have a relationship with their doctor. So since 2008, we had that 27.5% increase. Putting in these biometric screenings and starting to work and change our culture with wellness and exercise and right choice of eating and teaching and lunch and learns and all of these things, the next year we saw a 15% increase in health insurance. The following year, a 3% increase as our participation got close to 90%. And in the following year, we actually saw for the first time a 1.15% decrease in premiums. That was a $6 million swing for us. So you could see by starting to get people to pay attention, putting in a walking program, Dr. Chaudhary said, take a walk. We put a walking program in, some prizes, some incentives also to get people geared up. We also made it mandatory for the spouses that if they wanted to be on our insurance, they had to participate in the program. They were half of our high-cost claims. We saw a lot of high-cost claims in the beginning with colon cancer and breast cancer. As we put in our program and we had points given, they had their mammograms and their preventative screenings, we have seen that breast cancer, although not eliminated, it's found in the lesser stages because the women are having their annual mammograms. We're seeing 90% compliance in preventative screenings. We also gave points for colonoscopy. Who here really is anxious about having a colonoscopy? But if you get 40 points in the program, people are lined up at the door. So so we're actually at like 56% where we were about 17% compliance before. So starting to build a program where you get people to pay attention, have a little bit of fun with it. The population is healthier. They're more apt to be able to take care of our patients. Their backs are stronger. Their core is stronger because healthcare is a heavy job. All the jobs are heavy. Lifting patients, transferring patients, so it's important. Also, their wellness of their mind, their spirit. You know, having employees come to work and be happy, not be angry, that's certainly the experience you would want as a patient in our organization. So we've been able to make a lot of positive changes. We continue to build our program. We had 94% participation last year. And we've actually, last year, our claims were down $6 million from the year before. So we tied to the benefits, that gives them a reason, and now that's just part of our culture as we're moving forward.
Hi, welcome everybody, and thank you so much for having me here. My name is Laurie Sendro, and I'm the program director for two of our Faith in Action sites in Westmoreland County, and that's Greater Greensburg and Allegheny. All of the sites, actually, starting from the north, would be Allegheny. There's a site also in Murraysville, Harrison City, Greater Greensburg, and the Mount Pleasant area, which is the Jacobs Creek Faith in Action. Show of hands, how many of you have heard of Faith in Action? Oh, wonderful, wonderful. And we are actually, we're a program of the United Way of Westmoreland County. And what we do is we provide non-medical care and assistance to seniors who are, we call them 60 years of age and older. And the assistance that we provide, as I said, it's non-medical and it's not personal care. But what we do is, for their wellness and assistance, we provide transportation to doctor appointments. We help them, assist them with grocery shopping, or we take grocery orders so they can have the nutrition that they need. We help to keep them socialized either by transporting them to senior centers, or we make many, many phone calls to just to talk with them and see how they're doing, to check on them as often as they need or as they would like. Call them on their birthdays. We send them birthday cards. Check on them at least quarterly to make sure they're okay and to see if they need anything. We also provide caregiver relief. which is just a couple hours a week for the primary caregiver, whether it's the spouse or a child or someone who needs to be with them 24/7. Give them the opportunity to go shopping, get their hair done, just take a breather for a couple hours to give themselves a break. We also do home safety checks, which really, it's a wonderful service. We have two volunteers who will go into the home, and it takes about an hour for the two volunteers to go through, do a 91-point checklist, and then we also work with a licensed contractor who will, at no cost to the senior, put in safety bars, whether it's by the toilet, in the shower, so that they are safe. And so there's no charge for that. Also with loose handrails and things like that. We also provide supportive home visits. And again, this is no charge. And the reason for that is we are volunteer-based. 100% of our services are provided by volunteers. So it, and when I think of it, it's not a new concept. This is what we used to do for probably since the beginning of humanity, is we would take care of each other in communities, in villages, in towns. And it just seems that, as I can see it, in the past 50 years or so, because I grew up in a close neighborhood, and there are still close neighborhoods, but it just seems that times have changed and children are moving away and people work longer. They work longer hours. They work harder. There are just so many people working that these lovely people who have built our communities, and it doesn't happen abruptly. It just kind of happens slowly where they end up alone. And they end up kind of forgotten about. And if they don't have the, I don't want to say the courage, but if they don't tell someone that they need help, many of them can end up without medical care because they can't get transported. I mean, they need the transportation to get to the doctor. They don't have groceries because they don't know who to call. Maybe they've counted on a neighbor for years, but the neighbor is sick. Or the neighborhood has gotten into a nursing home. But anyway, the mission of this program is to help seniors 60 and older remain in their homes for a longer period, to keep them stable in their homes, to keep them, if they do not need nursing care, if they don't need personal care, to keep them happy and to keep them kind of settled in their homes where they can live a longer time, just being happy and knowing they have the transportation and the care that they need.
So faith in action, isn't that beautiful, faith in action? I think faith can be an action and be able to sustain a community and still do the business. We don't have to lose faith to do business. That really can be done. So I will kind of now begin a little dialogue here. And that dialogue, all of you are invited to chime in, ask questions, and kind of explore the possibilities. I was stunned by a few observations. I also want to kind of replay a little thing that happened during the planning committee meeting. So Sister Judy, you're not expecting me to call upon you, but I have. That's you, Sister Judy. Who else? You want to come up here for a second? Sister Judy looks at me, what are you doing? This is not part of the program. I just wanted to have Sister Judy share with us, why did she want to have Dr. Christopher Bellicini being part of the panel so that she can speak what she was speaking during that meeting?
Well, two of our sisters were taken care of by Dr. Bellicini. He called me very often to tell me what was happening to the sister. The one in particular had a fractured hip. She was in the hospital for 3 days before he was able to actually operate. He wished that she could have been fed, but every day there was a delay. And then finally, when he was able to provide her with the care, and have this to get home because the cardiologist was worried about something and someone else was worried. And he said, she needs to be home. She needs to be where she's with people that love her, that know her. She needs to be where she'll be fed. Would you like to say any more about that?
I think that particular case is one of many that healthcare has changed. I've been doing this alone for 8 years. When I started training, it was you had more time to spend examining the patient and actually having a discussion with them and their family and their loved ones. Nowadays, there's really no time to communicate. If I had my daughter is actually here. She's too young to draw a picture. But in a couple of years, she would be able to draw a picture, and she'll be five. If I took a five-year-old child and had them draw a picture of a healthcare provider or a nurse, today they would draw a picture of a nurse or a physician sitting at a laptop computer typing. If it would be me, it would be two index fingers pointing at keys. Not long ago, a decade ago, if you had a five-year-old draw a picture of a healthcare provider, it would probably be a nurse changing a dressing or rolling someone or manipulating an elderly patient in bed. And the same would hold true for any healthcare provider. It's changed these days. I think that the goal of the new healthcare program is, and to be bold, is to try to cut cost, to try to drive down the use of testing and studies that aren't necessary. But in my opinion, it's actually made it more difficult to actually be a human. We grow up and we're raised and we're developed to have an art to either work with people or not. And then we go on to our secondary education to learn the skills to provide our specialty. I think if we all took time to use more communication, less documentation on a computer, which I really do believe very few people actually read, I think that you would cut costs tremendously. It was very simple. That particular case is one of probably 30 to 50 I do per month, where I'll call a family member and talk about their loved one, and I'll be quite specific. Their mortality of surviving a particular surgery may be 10%. Their mortality of not having that particular procedure will be close to 80 to 100% in a 3 month period of time with pain. And away from their friends or loved ones. The sisters made it very simple with providing that particular care to that patient, because on the first encounter, one of the other sisters said to me, do what you can to get her back to us as soon as possible, because she gets confused in the hospital setting. This is very common in the elderly patients. Well, healthcare now has provided us guidelines in which we're to follow. With guidelines takes away a little bit of the art to provide care. These guidelines lead us to a hospital specialist performing a yes or no answer to whether the patient needs surgery. Many times they don't even know what surgery we're going to be performing, but yet they have to give a yes or no answer. It's really not a yes or no answer, it's a risk assessment. And is that risk going to change what we can provide the patient? Many times, because of a fear of liability, that medical doctor or hospitalist will consult two or three other specialists. That in there drives up healthcare cost. Ironically, all three notes, medical, cardiology, and pulmonary note, reads exactly the same thing at the end. Moderate to high risk on, I would assume, 80 to 90% of patients, and particularly the elderly patients who have osteoporotic type fractures. It's well documented that the longer you wait to provide the definitive treatment, the higher the mortality and the less quality of life. In many respects, the elderly patient wants one thing, quality of life. They understand their time is remaining. It's our job to provide that quality of life. We should put on the back burner thinking about cost to provide care. But if we just had that and took into consideration the communication early on with the patients and their loved ones, we can deliver the care much quicker, efficiently,
with less cost, which is a terrible thing to say when you're taking care of humans, but we are forced to these days, so that we can have the monetary capabilities to take care of more people. And I do believe that, and there's been many patients I've taken care of, whether they're in an emergent fashion or even an elective patient who's sent to my office for an arthritic joint or an ailment that may require surgery, and we come to the conclusion as a patient and a patient's family member, their families all agree to pursue that route, but then we can't get them cleared to go to the operating room to have that elective surgery that they want, that they truly could have, with their associated risk or potential benefit that they could achieve. But the same provider who initially referred them to us is now saying they can't have it. The analogy I would give to that is like taking a horse and leading it to water and saying, now you can't drink that water. That's also wasted healthcare. And I think that that's what led to my invitation here. It is a frustrating thing, but it's something that I've grown thick skin and I can deal with. It's just every day is a work in progress to try to find more and more individuals who have that same thought process. Thank you.
I really want to have our doctors speak their mind, as you know, as you just heard. There were some keywords. He likes to treat other people like humans, right? Don't we all like to be treated like a human, yes, rather than a next in line? Also, you know, the word fear was mentioned. The fear of the programs and the peers and how they generate that fear. And really wanting to talk more and communicate more was the wish, right? Isn't that beautiful? Absolutely beautiful. I sit down around 80 to 90, if you're, whatever you're doing in your life, if you're a nurse, you know, you have more nurse friends, you know, so I have a lot more doctor friends than not, just by reason of my profession. And this is a conversation we have almost all the time. I wish I had more time. I wish I could do more. I wish I could do more care. Because doctors, after all, are human beings. They want to be acting like human beings and delivering human being-like care. So if you have a doctor who's not able to do that, it's not that the doctor does not want to. Sometimes they're unable to. It just is, because I worked at Braddock Hospital, and I was expected to finish up my rounds in 2 hours, talk to about 7 or 8 other doctors from insurance companies during that time, do all my notes, and make sure that they meet the standard and the requirements and everything. And there was no way in the world that I could do what ordinarily would require me 7 or 8 hours to do that in 2 hours. There was no way. So when I had my first patient who jumped and killed himself in a river, I said, I would never do a care which is not a good care. Okay, because that human being who was discharged, he jumped off the bridge and killed himself, was enough for me to know that care cannot be a good care, you know? And so thus I decided to kind of part my ways from the HMOs and all these runs of life to be in places and situations where I can actually take care of myself as a human being and also take care of the people who trust me, right? So is there a nurse in this audience other than Sister Judy? Okay, so there are two nurses here, okay. Could one of you volunteer to speak your mind as a nurse, how your life has changed from the time when you started nursing, and how the nursing is these days or have been in the lately? Would you?
I'm going to speak later this afternoon, and that's part of what I'm going to say.
Okay.
But thanks for asking.
Okay. All right. So, but you, can you resonate with some of the conversation which is going on here?
I've been a nurse. I've been a nurse my entire life. I went into a hospital school of nursing when I was 18 and a half years old. And I was also in a division, and I was never sure what I was developing into. A nurse or a member of the Sisters of Charity. I finally got it together. I called my mom and lost company. But it was a very different world. It was right before Medicare. Patients were in wards, and they had little privacy but a lot of human support. When you would walk into the ward, one of the patients would say, "That man over there needs you." The hospital where I was in school had all board certified physicians, which was highly unusual, very high level of care, compulsive education of nurses. But it was a system that did not sustain itself financially. After Medicare and mergers and incredible change in the public Russian community where the hospital was located, and when I got past there, it's now a low-rated, if you believe Medicare rating of long-term care facilities, low-rated nursing care for older people, some skilled nursing is done by a for-profit company. And every once in a while, a new person who was a patient there, or another person that was a student there or worked there, and they talk about, don't we wish, I wish we could go back to that.
So,
I'm going to say something
to you in a second. Sure. Stay tuned for that as well.
Sister Rosemary Donley, I mean,
I'm with
the company.
Beautiful. Thank you, Sister, for your comments. And so this is a story that I hear from nurses all the time. So as was said by Laurie, how the caregivers are so very depleted themselves because of the various demands that are imposed upon them. And many of them do not even make any sense, but those demands have to be met as part of the peer's demandingness, that they demand such and such thing, and whatever, you know, the algorithms. And a friend, he left, he's a psychiatrist, Barry Fisher, he left, you know, the usual medical setting to go to VA health system, because he felt that that was a system where there were not a lot of insurance issues and the peer issue. I just caught up with him a couple of Mondays ago, and he said, "I'm leaving that too. There's so many algorithms and demands now from that system that I cannot practice as a clinician anymore." You know? So he's choosing another system to go to just because he cannot. And here's the comment I want to make. Good care actually saves resources, and we have more money in the bank than fragmented, rushed, and hurried, fearful care. There's absolutely no question in my mind. I had the opportunity of working for the healthcare in agencies such as Highmark as a consultant and Value Behavioral Health. When the systems operate in a way which makes sense, they actually have more resources to be able to use for their benefit. And that is, I mean, I know, and I just make a comment there. So as we were looking at a system level matters, we were from Value Behavioral Health when I was a medical director at once upon a time. We could see 9 county administration of healthcare dollars. Fayette County and Beaver County said, we want to do part of the care ourselves because we know our own residents. So there was a risk sharing kind of a phenomenon going on. And so they knew who were their high utilizers of healthcare. They would do a lot more preventive interventions. So rather than saying when a person is very ill, now they meet the criteria for admission, they would do that earlier on so that a person is not that very ill. So they would save their healthcare dollar. And that was a county which had a lot of money left to develop new programs for their residents. So the counties which were kind of doing business as usual, Westmoreland County being one, you know, there's a number we say PM, you know, per member cost. Westmoreland County had actually highest cost per member for their healthcare, you know, revenue, I mean, you know, expenses for their you know, population. So what we are talking about is making sense, and you're seeing that in action at Excela Health System. This is absolutely so very refreshing to hear how you have engaged your, you know, employees and helped them engage them in some dialogue. So I'm also open for anyone who wants to ask questions to our panelists. as well as if anyone in the panelists wants to add to the already existing comments. I have many other things, but as I said, I promise for myself to talk less. That is hard. But are there any questions for our panelists from the audience in regards to how they're working through the systems? Yeah, there's a question.
Not only a question, but I have worked at the CNA at times, and what I've seen is not only as a therapist do I have to have a certain amount of time for each client, and you know, the turnover piece of healthcare and getting paid and seeing so many individuals, but also when I worked in some nursing homes and places, you know, I'm like, this is not our level care, what is going on? And I asked the head nurse about it, and she said, the system is so overrun, you don't have enough beds for people where they belong. So they're not getting the right care, so we have to, I worked in a facility where all the patients were to be ambulatory. And I wound up on the floor where I had to lift most of the patients because they didn't have room in nursing homes for them for the right of that level of care. And then on the Discovery Channel, they did some research on a couple of the homes, and some of them had to be closed for such, you know, inadequate care. And some of them, you know, were more barbaric. And they actually got closed in, I think Penhurst is up in Philadelphia. That probably got closed in 1987, I think. And so even though there's been good health care in some places, there's been poor health care in other places. And the system is just being overrun with health care getting better so people are living longer, and we don't have the beds and facilities needed to help them.
So as people are living longer, so there's obviously our lifespan has increased. There's no question about that. Part of that is because of the infectious diseases and disorders are not as much. You know, the hygiene in general is improved, and the care, healthcare is obviously better. But we also are going to be looking at the quality of life rather than just the quantity of life. Because we can have quantity of life being X number of years, but during that time, are we healthy, and are we vibrant, and are we living in a good manner, or we have a lot of diseases and disorders which are now part of our lifestyle. My assertion is that if we really take care of this body well, one is a tertiary intervention, which is when there's a disease and disorder by the time somebody has a heart attack, that was not the day that the heart attack is really happening all the way. That's the day when the heart could not take it anymore. You know, the insults that we have been giving to our heart throughout the time, we were not paying attention to our heart. There's a day when it gets our attention. So that by the time we have a osteoarthritic problem, and by the time the pain becomes very intense, that's not the day it really became intense. The process that was evolving, and there was a day when it got our attention, you know, that we could no longer do, and now we have to go see a doctor, right? And so tertiary interventions are very important, and then, you know, that's where, you know, the modern medicine is very vital. It allows us to make good diagnoses and allow us to do very profound interventions. But then we have to go back to looking at the primary intervention, that's where, you know, the walking and the healthy eating and the way we live our life, otherwise we will be having that problem again. You know, if my one artery is blocked today and that's opened up, and I continue to do what I was doing before, another one will close. It's a matter of time. You know? And then so we have to learn that it's important not to end up being on places where we will not even have rooms to enter because there's so many disease and morbidity that we don't have enough resources to hold illnesses. I mean, I get stunned at Sisters of Charity. There are some sisters who are 100 years old or 95 years old who was telling me, Sister Judy pointed out one time, she said, look at this sister, she must be close to 100 or close in the approximation, and she's walking around, she had smiled from ear to ear. It was absolutely stunning. And how many people, I mean, how many of us can be having a smile year to year at that age and still working? There's something to be learned. There really is something to be learned. I think that's marvelous, and that's why I keep coming back here, because I want to learn from sisters what's their secret.
It's in the water.
It's in the water. Go ahead.
Thank you for talking about the scene.
My question is, it's very obvious that you have a youthfulness in your profession. And do you have any observation of medical professionals in your area that you can converse with at the level that you explained to us? Do you see young doctors, young medical professionals coming into the profession with your sense of service and dedication to the human development of your patients? So is there, well, I guess I'm getting to is there a hopefulness that you see that you and your colleagues at your age see some breakthrough in changing some things that are occurring with health insurance and stuff so that that human element can be brought back into your profession?
That's a very good question. I think a good question deserves a good answer. And I will, my observation, please take this with a grain of salt. I work in a community health system. But I do take medical students, physician assistant students, nursing students observe me constantly, even some residents I take. Many of the medical students that come to see me are students who do want to do my particular field. Orthopedic surgery is a sought after, demanded, it's in demand. It's a hard residency to get. Very few of the students that I get, I think, should become orthopedic surgeons. I think that, to be quite honest, it starts early on in your career. I was saying earlier that you're raised in a certain way and you develop in a certain way to develop skills to work with people. But then you have to decide what type of work can you provide and where will your skills be best utilized. I have an older brother who's also a physician who chose my field for me. I didn't really understand. I didn't know what orthopedic surgery even was, probably into medical school. I knew that there were doctors who fixed bones, and I probably didn't even know in high school, I may have, but that you could replace joints or replace parts of the body to make people function longer and have quality of life. I have noticed a difference in medical education, and I believe many of us probably have. I think when you a computer can only teach you so much, and an artificial simulation can only teach you so much. Very few medical schools have cadavers anymore. Cadaver feels completely different than a rubber thing that you manipulate while you're in training, or a computer that you slide through and you flip through layers of muscle layers to look at nerves and arteries. If the older way of education would weed out those who could not even be in the operating room. So many of the students who come to me as medical students who want me to write letters of recommendation for them for a residency in surgery, we've had several pass out in the operating room. And now that changes in time. Many of you who are nurses have known the first time you may get that feeling of, wow, I'm only looking at this blood or this procedure, manipulation of the body or cutting of a bone, and you get this basal vagal type response and you pass out. That happens in it, and you can develop a tolerance to it. But I'm astounded by how many people have gone so far in their career, their third or fourth year of medical school, have not even touched inside the body, but yet they know they want to be an orthopedic surgeon. So I do think there's going to be a change. I really do. In addition, the ability to physically examine a patient is being taken away from people because you have to be at a computer for a prolonged period of time. It's much longer than any hospital administrator thinks or any patient or patient family thinks. So it's very difficult. Sister Judy is very easy to talk to because she looks after a lot of people. She is a nurse herself. But many family members, when I call them and have to speak with them, it's more than just a 5 to 10 minute conversation on the phone to explain what we have to do, what the expectations are after the surgery, what long-term expectations are, and then a side conversation, what if we do nothing, okay? So I think that at a time where they're changing residency programs where you can no longer work for so many hours a week, I do think it's gonna change. And we must, I mean, everyone who works, the majority of people in the world who work expect an economic return for what you do. As reimbursement changes and you have to work harder to earn the same amount of money, it's gonna change what you want to become. So I think that there's gonna be a lot of very intelligent people, and this is just honesty speaking, if I had a really smart person who could probably do anything, they could be any surgeon they want, or a biomechanical engineer that's bilingual, a high probability that the biomechanical engineer that's bilingual can work for a biotech company will make more money than most physicians. So you're going to have a lot of qualified people who will go into other fields. I do feel that way. Now, there are always people who are good-natured people who have it in their heart to want to care for people, but you still can become that biomechanical engineer working for a biotech company and volunteer weekends and take care of people and live a better life. Does that make sense to you? And sometimes honesty is hard to hear, but I see it. I see right through some of the students who come to me. And I ask them, why do you want to be an orthopedic surgeon? The majority, when I was in high school, I had an injury. They liked that appearance of going somewhere where there's athletic trainers who got to work with them, and they had these fancy like ice tubes that wrapped around their leg. That's not the answer that we need to hear. You know, you want to be able to hear that, hey, I like that you're doing something to provide long-term quality of life for someone. And I think I have the talent and the capability, based on what I've already done, that I can do that. Thank you.
So these are beautiful questions, and I just want to make a comment. I'm so very glad. I mean, this great conversation is taking place. I mean, you are looking for hope, for a change, and we are saying we like to see the hope too. You know, how would that come around and happen? I think it will take time. My comment, it's going to happen at a very organic level, one by one, you know, for us to say, if the government is going to change and the big bodies aren't going to change, we will change. We will change where we can change. And rather than feeling very powerless and useless and unable, that's the vision of Sedan. Sister Sedan had a vision. She changed as a woman. She brought a lot of change. We have a few more questions back there. Identify yourself too.
I'm sitting comfortably on my leg. This is not a question, but I think it's valuable in this context right here. First, what you said, Dr. Chaudhary, about the sisters and it being contagious, and you started to pass that on to me. And I was kind of forced, if you will, into private practice only about 6.5 months ago. And I liked Sister over there with the nurse thing and everything. I was having some pastoral education and not sure where, as a married laywoman, could fit in the Catholic Church as a pastoral background. So then I get this marriage and family therapy degree. And so it's starting to flourish now because of what you all are starting to bring to the table, because there is a place for people like us who have strong commitment to human values. Outside of an order, outside of a church setting, you do take a hit financially. But some of the hope that I'm sitting here thinking of is, and I've always thought of something to try to keep me humble for years, is when my light's shining, oftentimes it's because someone else's light was sort of dim in other people's lives. And just last night, I had a client wait 20 minutes for me. And when I came out, and I won't get into the circumstances, but when I came out of the office with the other client, they were leaving, and I apologized to her. She said, "You've spent a lot of time with us over time," so she was patient because of someone else's wait, because I've done that with them as well. This same person just said to me how she hates this Aetna thing, because I'm not participating with Aetna because I came in when the panel's closed. I'm going to keep trying, but I have three clients right now paying out-of-network benefits for my care because they have hit the roadblocks, what you're hearing here. Poor care, not feeling as though they were even anything worth anything to whoever they went to. And these are for people with children. That's on top of that. When you want a child, when you have a child in therapy, you want best care. And so she said, "Well, at least I can go to both hospital systems." You can see them, you know. She goes, "And coming to you meets my deductible quicker, so that when I go to these other places, I won't have to pay as much." And she said, "But I feel like my son has got better care from you in the last 2 months than we've gotten in the last three therapists." And she brought me to tears. And that's what many of my clients also have had the privilege of my vulnerability and them seeing what Dr. here is offering us as well, a piece of ourselves. And I just can't believe, because when I'm feeling like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna be poor the rest of my life, these clients are giving me hope that this is the way to keep going. And this conference right here has helped me, so thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for your very kind comments. Our vulnerabilities are beautiful, and that makes us human, and that makes us precious. And our goal is eventually to ask Sister Catherine to include all of us in the Sisters of Charity. So that we have a wing dedicated to those people who attended their first conference. So there's always a little agenda that's at play to say, "Well, we're good enough to come here and live with you too." So thank you for your comment.
Good morning, I'm Ron Ott from Excela Health, and we're very pleased to be a part of this wonderful conference sponsored by the Sisters of Charity with a focus on wellness. I don't know that healthcare necessarily gets recognized as focusing on wellness as much as treatment, but that's clearly a lot of our focus moving forward. A couple of quick comments. First, to really acknowledge Dr. Chris Bellicini. Not only is he a superior, and I truly mean that, superior orthopedic surgeon, but you can hear from his comments today, probably one of the most caring and compassionate individuals, not necessarily physicians, but individuals that I know, and we're truly very blessed to have him be a part of Excela Health in this community. So thank you, Chris, very much, truly. Comment with Laurie, and you know, Laurie did a great job explaining our journey with wellness. What she didn't mention, and Laurie's not the kind of person to do that, but it's important to know that not only did this really help our employees at Excela Health, but we've actually been recognized as one of the healthiest employers in the region by the Pittsburgh Business Times the last 4 years in a row, and last year nationally 34th in the nation because of Laurie and her team's efforts. So congratulations, Laurie, on that. It really is great. She talked about our mission to improve the health and well-being of every life we touch. Our vision statement is actually to be a high-quality, value-driven health and wellness system and to proactively improve and manage the health of our population. So what we're trying to do is to take our success, and it truly is a journey that we've done with our employees, and we're partnering with probably 24 employers in the region as well too, trying to identify some of the same issues where they can improve the health and wellness of their employees. One, because it's the right thing to do, but two, because it helps them manage their costs as well too. So we've seen that as a benefit, but it's part of our commitment, and the employer community has been very good about that. And again, that's a journey, but we look for the opportunity to partner with them. One last comment, and to Dr. Chaudhary's point about Westmoreland County and the overall health of the population. One of the outgrowths of the Affordable Care Act and Obamacare is for hospitals to complete community health needs assessments. So over the past couple of years, and we actually partnered with the United Way to do that. They did a health assessment from their standpoint. We did a community health needs assessment. And part of that was really encouraging the opportunity to not just have Excela Health do it, but to work with a lot of community stakeholders to really identify things that go beyond just what healthcare can do, but with all the other social organizations, how they can actually impact health too in terms of access and economy and all the issues that really impact health. So it was a great experience for us. What we found out, and there were a lot of priorities that we could address, but the number one priority we focused on was weight management and obesity, because we felt that that leads to diabetes, which leads to coronary heart disease and hypertension. So it was the major issue that we identified in Westmoreland County. And as a result of that, we developed implementation strategies and partnerships with primary care doctors and our school districts, putting in a Project Fit America program with the YMCAs doing a diabetes prevention program and a lot with our other social organizations. So again, it's very much a journey. We're sort of midway of our first three-year community health needs assessment, and we'll be looking at that data and our results and tweaking it and doing a second community health needs assessment in the future. So there's a lot of other information, and with the great group that's here, you know, we can follow up with you on what we're doing from a wellness standpoint and see if we can maybe do some additional partnerships in the future. But congratulations again to the Sisters of Charity. This is just a great conference, and we're pleased to be a part of it. Thank you.
I would like to support all of that for Excela Hospital and just acknowledge that there is a collaboration that is going on with Excela and the Sisters of Charity and United Way and Signe Hill University. And we have a little program that we started a year and a half ago, and it's called Books for Babies. And Excela Hospital supports this in this fashion, that when a child is born at Excela Hospital, the parents are introduced to a Read to Your Child program as an infant. And so parents are encouraged to read to their infant right there in the hospital. And United Way provides 5 to 7 items in a packet that the Sisters of Charity here at the ages of 85, 90, 93 package. And so every month we package 400 bags of these materials. And through United Way and Excela Hospital and university, because then what we do is we invite students at the university to participate in the packaging. So when they come, it's great because they do the heavy work and the sisters can do the lighter work at the age of 95. So the combination of the youth working with the elderly here at Caritas Christi, they know that all this material is coming from United Way. They are exposed to Excela Hospital, which then is distributing the materials, and also in Uniontown at the hospital there. So I think collaboration and understanding and the variety of age levels that can come together certainly is important to this idea and this philosophy of total wellness.
Thank you, that beautiful comment. And yes, this reaches my heart that we are connecting the dots of various programs, getting to know what the systems are doing at a larger scale and on a very organic scale, you know, how things are changing. I really do believe very firmly, if we get out of our victimized role, whether we are administrators or a human being, we really can change the landscape of healthcare ourselves. We don't need the blessings of something that's beyond our reach.
This is more of a comment than a question. It is about compassion we lost in healthcare. I worked at Jeanette Hospital from 1970 to 2006, and that came to an end when there was a hospital-wide meeting, and the CEO talked about how our production was down and how we needed to get more products in. We were not General Tyler at the bottom of the hill at the internet. We were a healthcare facility that started with the Sisters of Charity, and that's who I work with, and that's who taught me about the compassion with our patients. And I think we lost that with the insurance and trying to get our income up in the hospitals. And it was like, it was always, we need to get more patients, we need to have more push through during the day. Okay, we only have 10 in the GI that day. We want to have 25 tomorrow, and it's push, push, push. And that's the way it is in healthcare now. We don't have the time to really learn the patient and have a hospitalist. That hospitalist does not know that patient. That patient's primary care doctor knows. But that hospitalist is making that decision on that patient's care, like Dr. Bellicini said, and he can just be making a patient on a cadaver because there's no communication of the patient's lifestyle, their past history. That's all lost. I don't want that kind of care. I don't want to be part of that. So what happened that day in that meeting, when I heard those words, when I went to sleep that night, the Holy Spirit, something told me, you have to get out of this profession. And I got up in the morning and I told my husband, I have to quit work. That is not the hospital that I started to work in. And he said, quit. I went in and turned in my 2 weeks notice that day. And that gave me the time. I now volunteer. And I have all the freedom to go and be with people and sit and talk with them. And I just had to get away from that. Well, why is healthcare changing so much? It's a business now. It's not human beings anymore. And who's going to take care of us? I'm frightened of that. I take care of myself. I don't go to the doctors. Only my yearly check. One more. Because I'd rather take care of myself because I hear myself. The doctors.
Beautifully stated. And that's a story of many of us, you know. That's a story of many of us who find ourselves in a situation in our lives that we find the balance is tipping towards that place where we don't feel comfortable anymore. And I was sharing in a group of physicians. I have a lot of people who work now for UPM. I have a lot of friends who now work for UPMC health system. It's a good system, it's doing its job, but many of them are not happy clinicians. And I say that without any reservation because I really don't care in this moment. And if I was in their situation, I would be thinking about tuition for the children, the mortgages, the car payment, you know, all of those necessary kind of stuff, because we feel that those are important items and, you know, as was earlier stated, you know, I really do believe, and here's we have to have that faith which is beyond a peer system. Before the UPMC was in existence, people lived, right? So there, before UPMC came into existence as an employer and as an insurance carrier, did people not live? Did they not make their car payments? Did their children not go to the schools and colleges? Who provides us with that very basic thing is not UPMC, it is something much bigger than the UPMC, right? Mm-hmm. Who is sustaining our life? Who is allowing us to go to sleep and wake up in the morning? No. Do you think that we have a clue when we are sleeping what's happening to us? We are in a state of death, right? So big or small, medium or this, but somebody keeps us breathing, right? Something keeps our heart beating, right? No. And the vital functions are still happening, that something is much more important than any other employer. And we have to have that belief, whether we are a doctor, whether we are nurses, whether we are a recipient of care. If that belief is lost, the fears will come in abundance, and the worries will come in abundance. And we have to remember that as we are contemplating about life and discerning about life. And I think that's a very vital piece of the puzzle. Because somehow or the other, we are going to live this life, either fearfully or lovingly. At least in psychiatry, after 30 years of practice and learning, I've learned some very basic principles. We can live this life fearfully or mindfully. Those are the two choices we can make. And living mindfully will still provide us with sustenance. Fearfully will create more heart attacks and more gut problems and more issues and more of those matters. So I think you took a very daring step. And remember, that's not going to go nowhere. It's going to percolate. You know, spirits work in a different way than the larger system that play it. Any other comments, questions before we...
Thank you for the comment that healthcare has become a business, which it has. So I have tried to train myself over the years, having spent a number of those years working in healthcare, to always refer, you know, we call it the healthcare industry, which brings an image to my mind of Ford Motor and the assembly line, you know, that's an industry. So I've retrained my thinking and my speaking to refer to it as the healthcare ministry or the healthcare service. And even when people make the comment to me and say, well, the healthcare industry, I say, oh yeah, and the healthcare service, and just try to gently even reorient other people's thinking. And it might help if we send our thinking in a different direction. It is not an industry. This is not Ford or General Motors. This is people.
And this is very, very beautifully stated. I remember I was then consulting an HMO, and so they brought in a consultant who apparently used the Toyota car model. There must be a model which basically says, you know, that each car can be made very well, and the productivity and whatever that model is. And she did our training. She did our training. So we are healthcare providers sitting there, learning how that Toyota car is made from scratch, made very well, and we were told this is how this system will now operate. And I'm not kidding. I said, what's a Toyota car? I said, car is a material. You know, I said, you know, each human being is very different. They're not Toyota car. You know, they come in, they may look the same way, but they may have different needs and different issues and different matters. You cannot use the same model for human beings because human beings are really so very complex and so very different than the one that you see before. There are a lot of commonalities, but there are a lot of differences of managing them relationally as well. So that's very beautiful. So the industry is what is now happening. Service is what we are striving for, right? And if even in this room, we all make that commitment to make it a service that we already are saying. Even in this room, we don't need a gigantic number of people. Even in this room, if we make that commitment, we can change the world. We really can change the world. And I'll finish up. Are there any other comment or question before I close in? Okay.
Just a little comment, because I didn't want to scare people and sound too negative, and I feel like there's going to be a change in healthcare. We all know that answer. That's why you asked the question. What she just said, it reinforces my belief in what I've observed. She sounds like a really good nurse who wanted to be a nurse to care for people, not sit behind and worry about, were you still there when, you know, the measures you have to meet, you know, the protocols, or your hospital gets dinged and how much it truly gets reimbursed. It goes along what you described as painting a stick to look like a carrot, really offering someone a carrot. What the government has done is imparted upon our health systems who do have to make some money to reinvest in the institution. We have to work together as a team with them. Unfortunately, our administrators have to abide by these rules in order to justify, boy, we have to be able to truly capture this much reimbursement to offer more to our population that we're serving. And if you don't meet it, and if you're your workers don't meet it, we're not going to make you whole. It's sad that as a society, we will respond more to a negative punishment later, such as what you've observed, to a positive return. What I see is many nurses and doctors like yourself, not only in those last few years you were working as a care provider, early on in your career when you didn't have the nuisance and the headache of trying to making sure a checklist, has the patient had their anticoagulation or their antibiotic discontinued within 24 hours after surgery. The sad part about it is, if you were interrupting caring for two patients by one patient who needed you to help them go to the bathroom, it delayed you giving the antibiotic postoperatively 5 minutes to care for another patient. On a piece of paper, the whole system looks bad because 4 minutes later, you 24 hours and 4 minutes, an antibiotic was delivered. The doctor gets a letter, like a little demerit. You didn't give your antibiotic, discontinue your antibiotics postoperatively within 24 hours because a computer generated that information. You so much want to yell at that computer and say, well, that was because my nurse was helping someone go to the bathroom. Is it really common sense? Is it going to change anything? Absolutely not. So the answer to everyone will be, oh no, if I open up a hospital right next to a modern day hospital where nurses and physicians had to document very little, just the bare necessities so that they can give the following care provider the information needed to take over care the next day. Plus we would have more time to talk to one another rather than worry about our writing and what we were truly trying to communicate one another via pen, pencil, or computer. If it was a common sense hospital where you could just actually spend time with the patient, nurses and physicians, talk more to people, and then put right next to a hospital to have to meet all of the demands that are placed upon a health system, by word of mouth, that other hospital is going to succeed in the long run. But it's going to look really bad on a piece of paper in a month. Does that make sense? So every day I have a nurse who says they're leaving. Just one who I really, really like a lot that works with me in the operating room. She told me I can't take it much longer and she's gonna retire earlier. And she's telling me this because she said, work with another nurse, see if she can be the new me. And I respected that she had that much confidence in herself to say that. She still tries to take the time to train those that she sees have the same feeling, but she's really frustrated, like you probably felt. And that's what's hurting healthcare.
So here is it's now time is up. I know that we could have another comment. I like to stay on time and then have our conversation continue during this dialogue. So thank you for all those who participated in this moment.
Comment for the sisters. You know, when we started our wellness program, we had one really great advocate, and she was actually a sister from here, I believe, and she worked in our lab. And when we rolled out our pedometer program, she was registering. We were asking 5,000 steps to start out a day. The CDC says 10,000 steps you should achieve each day. She was getting 20,000 steps every day. And people were like, that just is impossible. How is she doing it? And she was 70 years old, and she got up at 5 a.m. and walked the parameter, reading her Bible every morning, and got her 20,000 steps in before she started work. So I just want to give credit where credit is due.
Thank you for the panel. Thank you for your conversation. We will now have a break, I guess.
We're going to thank you very much. That was wonderful. Let's give them a round of applause. Thank you.